Thank you all for coming. It's very exciting. We've been planning this event for quite some time, and it's my honor to introduce you to our guests this evening. First, we have Mr. Tim Boyle. Such a great story. I can't wait to hear it all and for all of your questions as well. But Mr. Boyle was here at the University of Oregon when, unfortunately, his father passed, and his mother asked him to come back to the very small company, which wasn't even $1 million at the time, to come back and help run the company. I'm going to let him fill in the blanks, but now he's running a $2.5 billion iconic company, global company. So that's going to be incredible. To his left is a longtime friend of mine and collaborator, Scott Kerslake. And Scott is also quite the entrepreneur. We have two amazing people here. Scott started... had a dream. I think he'll probably tell us about his idea. He had a dream, and he had a vision of what a company could be, and from that was the seeds of the company Athleta that many of you probably know. He was the founder and CEO of that for many years. He's done a number of things in between, which he'll talk to us about, but for the last 5 or 6 years, he's been the CEO of prAna, which has recently been purchased by Columbia. And prAna's rise is pretty amazing as well. And about 6 years ago, it was basically bankrupt. And it's a very healthy and growing company now. So we have two amazing entrepreneurs to tell us a lot of stories about strategy, leadership, ethics, values, and really how to scale a company in the appropriate way, in a progressive way. So we're going to get started now with Tim. Doing a short presentation, about 15 or 20 minutes. Scott will follow, and then we'll go to audience questions in the end. Tim, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. It's great to be back here. I mean, I don't get a chance to come back on campus very frequently. I come occasionally to go to a sporting event. But it was really interesting coming back here. Let me tell you how long it's been since I was a student at the University of Oregon. My junior year, I went for a run, and I was stopped by the police saying, "What are you doing?" Maybe it wasn't really a run at that time, but and it was also interesting going by 150 Science, the scene of my first F at the University of Oregon. I wish I could say it was my last one, but. So, as was said, my dad died. I was a senior at the University of Oregon, highly motivated to be in school here because males who were not in university were drafted when I was here, so I was highly motivated to stay in school. My dad died in December of my senior year, 1970. I'd gotten married about 4 months before that, so I really was in a quandary, and our business was nice enough to say it was $1 million, but it actually was just around that revenue number in 1970. So when I went home to help my mom run the business, and my mom had not been in the business before, so we were both sort of trying to learn how to do all this stuff. We were very successful at taking it down to $500 million by 1971. So then the trouble started. We really had no idea what we were doing running a business. At that time, it was a very small hat and cap business with a very small manufacturing facility. The business had been started by my mother's grandparents, my mother's parents, who immigrated from Germany to Portland in the late 30s. It was not a great place to be Jewish, so my grandfather brought his whole family to Portland, where his brother had immigrated years before. So we had this little business, family business. It was distributing headwear and a few items that we manufactured ourselves in a tiny little factory in St. John's, Oregon. We distributed our products in Oregon, Washington, Northern California, and Alaska. And we really had no idea what we were doing. My dad had just taken out an SBA loan prior to his death. So here we were trying to help run the business and save it. So we ran the business basically into the ground. In 1974, we had a negative net worth of around $300,000. and the bank called our note with really no prospects of survival. So we tried to sell the business. I ended up working with lots of investors and entrepreneurs who looked at the business and said, hey, why are you doing things like this? Shouldn't you really be thinking about that? So that was my MBA course, was trying to sell the business. We finally got somebody interested in buying it, and the offer was $1,400, and my mom wisely said, you know, I think we can drive it into the ground by ourselves for $1,400. So we got a few more months' time from our banker, who said, you know, you guys really need a board of advisors. You need some people to help you understand what you're doing. I'm just loaning some money to some guys starting a shoe business over here in Beaverton. Maybe I can get one of these guys to help you out, try and understand how to do business. So we had one of the very early Nike employees, a guy named Ron Nelson, who some of you may know that name, came on a board of advisors and said, you know, you guys are just concentrating on the wrong stuff. You need to be looking at this kind of stuff and not this kind of stuff. And so we were able to turn the business around. They were nice enough. Ron was nice enough to introduce us to the folks at Nisha EY that provided a significant amount of financing for Nike in the early days. And so we basically followed the Nike model, which is design, merchandise, market centrally in the globe, make the stuff where it's appropriate to make it, and you know, hopefully sell it everywhere. So that's the background here. I can tell you, this is my favorite slide. We went public in 1998, and I get to start every presentation with, this is the disclaimer. But today, Columbia is really a family of brands, including Mountain Hardware, Sorel, and prAna, most recently. And it's different than it was running a single brand company. So it's been a learning experience for me, and I've had a lot of help from Scott and others to help run the business in the proper way when you're talking about multiple brands. Let me talk to you about each brand. So the Columbia brand, you may know if you're a local Portland or Eugene person or Northwesterner. It's really all about, for us, protection. How to keep people outdoors longer, how to stay outdoors enjoying yourself. So we have products to keep people warm, keep people cool, keep people dry, and keep them protected. And that's really the focus of the product assortment that we put together and how we describe what our company's products do. So what we found, much like at Nike when they started showing consumers the airbags in the shoes, visible air, people understood immediately, okay, I get what this product is and how it's different. And so we started focusing on showing technologies about our products that were visible. So the Omni-Heat Reflective is a way to keep people warm. Our latest product is basically a reversed methodology for waterproof, breathable construction. Very unique, but it's, again, visible to the consumer because it looks dramatically different on the exterior. And Omni-Free Zeros, which is a product which actually has a molecular cooling system. When these polymers get wet with sweat, they swell up, absorb heat, and they actually keep you much cooler. So the other thing which we talk about a lot is how to differentiate our products. So nobody needs another brand of apparel or footwear. You know, there's millions of them in the world. So how do you make one that lasts, and how do you make people understand that it's different? We use my mom, who's different. And we've really focused on her persona and her ability to test the products. We launched a big marketing campaign again this last year, and been very successful. You know, one of the things that people who live in the Northwest may not know is how big a business we have in the tropics, primarily centered on saltwater fly fishing for different game fish there. And it allows us to be, again, different from our competitors. We have a real reason for being. And it's really been a terrific business that allowed us to expand our brand outside the typical cold, wet Northwest. We went into the footwear business in 1993, and frankly, it's been a terrific business. It hasn't grown nearly as much as it should, but it's one of the few products we make that actually wears out, so that's a good thing.
Hi, I'm Gerd Boyle, Chairman of Columbia Sportswear. My son Tim, our president, to demonstrate our interchange system. The liner zips in for maximum warmth. The outer shell is weatherproof. Wear it together or separately.
This tomorrow comes in dozens of styles.
I voted against that.
Columbia Sportswear.
It really wasn't as much fun as it looked like. So this is the latest edition. A little bit background on the Columbia brand. We bought this brand in 2000, Sorel. If you grew up snowboarding here in the area, you would recognize Sorel as being a snowboard boot, but frankly, it was a real workwear brand. It was designed as a working man's brand to keep cold in winter weather. So this is really the brand when we bought it, and frankly, the biggest customer for this product was Walmart, and the company went bankrupt, and we bought the intellectual property, and it was a nice little business. We paid the right amount of money for it, but we really converted into this today. It's really a women's protective fashion brand, and it's been very successful, and it's all about women. So our focus is on millennial females, really college students. There's 100 million college girls that go back to school every year. We want to cover at least half of those people with footwear. But it's really how we organize the product offering so that we can have a real clear picture of what it is that we're building and designing and marketing. Now, how do you take a winter men's boot brand and convert it, first of all, to a women's brand, and then how do you make this stuff in the springtime? And it's really all about having the right product and the right team of people putting the product together. And we've been really successful at organizing our teams to be able to go at this market. The business has grown nicely. We'll have close to $230 million business this year, and it was zero when we bought it. And you can see that the year we added the women's, it just started growing like crazy. So that's been very good for us. Mountain Hardware, when you think about our company and our collection of brands, not everything's been totally rosy all the time. Mountain Hardware's been a brand that we acquired in 2006. We didn't do the right things by the brand. We didn't follow what we normally would follow in terms of a product selection, people focus, and we had trouble with the brand. But we've hired a new team. Only a couple of months into the business management, but we're very excited about the potential to reinvigorate this brand. So we talk about Mountain Hardware reinvented. It's about getting back to innovation, back to the alpinist, back where the brand is really anchored in the climb and in winter specifically. So we have a number of brand pillars to build the brand back up to its former strength. Probably the best one is to compete to win. We really want to have people who are highly competitive focusing on the business, bringing it back to its former glory, and I think we're going to make it. But again, it's all about being different. So the brands that we compete with Mount Hardware, you may be familiar with North Face, Arc'teryx, Mammut, and there's other brands around the world that we compete with this brand. But it's really about getting a competitive, focused group together to build the brand back up. One of the ways we're going to be doing that is really iconic images, putting a team together that can build the brand up and have images that make it distinctly different. We'll have brand ambassadors that put together a collection of products and images that can bring the brand back to, its former glory. And one of the ways we're going to start doing that is with a new trade show booth. Typically, the industry that we're in gets together a few times a year in different places in the world. One of them is in Salt Lake City a couple times a year. One is in Munich, Germany a couple times a year. And we really want to be pointing out to the trade how we're changing the brand, changing the business. So you'll know how we do on this if you see a lot more of this stuff around. And prAna, the company's latest acquisition, what really interested us about prAna, especially the management team, because we don't have a really large group of managers running the business. We have a very narrow group, so Scott and his team brought real true management expertise to the business, and we felt very comfortable with him and his team. But again, it's about women, and this business has been historically way too focused on men. So Scott will talk about that, I think, in his presentation. The other interesting thing was it's basically an American or North American brand, and since our business is heavily weighted outside the U.S., we thought we could expand the distribution geographically. The other thing that made it really interesting was the fact that it was a lifestyle brand and really focused not necessarily on any particular kind of product, but really the feeling that people got when they used these kinds of products in various activities. Seasonal. Now, our business typically is around 60% fall-winter in total, and it was great to see a brand that was 50-50, and more importantly, again, heavily weighted towards women. So that's the company in total. It's a quick snapshot of what we're doing. Here is, for the global company, how we break down from a brand perspective. You see, still it's over 80% Columbia. We have basically a business model where we sell to retailers who are multi-brand retailers. So that's about 65% of the business. The balance is our own stores or stores that we control. Here's the regional look at it. So you can see almost 40% of the business is outside the U.S. And again, we thought we could expand the range of all of our brands, including prAna, outside the U.S. And then it's primarily an apparel business, although we have a keen focus on getting our footwear business becoming much larger. So here's how we distribute the company's products. In the orange or the yellow area, we sell to retailers who sell other products. So that would include Europe and North America and Japan. And then in the other, we have our own stores in some of these markets, as you can see. We have independent distributors in many of these markets around the world. And in China, we're just starting a joint venture operation there that's about 2 years old with a very large English company called Swire, which there are many, many kinds of businesses, including shipping and real estate. They own Cathay Pacific Airlines. They're an enormous company, but they've helped us to grow in that business. They've been doing business in China since the 1700s, so they sort of have it down. Again, focusing on direct-to-consumer, where we can really control what the brand looks like and feels like in these various places in the world. And at the end of the day, our banker, remember the guy who called our note, who was loaning money to Nike when nobody would loan money to them? He always preached, hey, you guys got to have a fortress balance sheet, because you never know what's going to happen. You got to make sure that you've got a strong balance sheet. So it's taken us a long time to put that together, but clearly, you know, we have over $450 million in cash. We have almost no debt. We have a repurchase available for our shares should we need that. And here's what our 2016 looks like. And again, I have to point out, this is the guidance we gave when we announced our first quarter earnings. So we're not reiterating that. To go back to that first slide, my favorite one. But this is what we expect to do in 2016. I think that's all I got.
Okay. Can you guys hear me okay? So while we get this queued up, tell me how many here are a little freaked out about finding the perfect job when they get out of school? Just a couple, right? So I'm here to tell you that to calm your nerves a little bit about that, I started in investment banking. And if you knew anything about me, I have absolutely no business being in investment banking. So I studied liberal arts undergrad, and graduation was coming up, and I figured I better get some business experience or I'm in big trouble. So somehow I talked my way into one of these investment banking programs with one of the large investment banks. And I knew nothing about business at the time. And again, I've got no business being in investment banking, but I'll tell you what, as a CEO, I use investment banking background, everything I learned, almost on a day-to-day basis, right? Then I wound up in management consulting. It's a fun story. So
Cambridge, Mass, amazing management consulting firm. We had just gone public, lots of stock options, all of the trappings and everything. One night when I'm flying from San Francisco back to Boston, I look out the window. You have to imagine this scene. I'm the only one on the airplane that's awake, so it's a red eye, right? So everybody in their right mind is asleep, everybody. And I'm that one guy that has the light on, you know,
and something just didn't feel right to me. Not about the plane. Right? About the plane going down. But something didn't feel right to me. And one of the things that I was wrestling with was really my own values and my own passions. And I looked out the window of the plane and I said, God, if equity was not part of the configuration here, and the compensation effectively was not part of the configuration, would I keep this job? I looked out the window and said, you know what, it took me about 5 seconds to realize, no, I would not keep this job. I landed in Boston in the morning, 5:45 in the morning, walked to my apartment, showered, got dressed, went to my job and resigned. It was a, you know, you've got these like critical inflection points in your life where you make decisions about different things. And you think that they're irrevocable and nothing, you know, your life is not going to go on after it and so forth. And so this is the connection back to me asking you guys that question, is how many of you are freaked out about finding the perfect job? If I told you guys that you will change your careers 5 to 7 times in your life, would you believe it? Particularly the generation that you guys are in, right? Everybody changes. The previous generations, from Tim's generation, people stuck with the job for a long period of time. Right? So go out and get experience and try new things. But I guess the thing I want to talk to you about this moment, which was really a poignant moment for me in my life, it was a real gut check around my own values. I think you guys are at the stage of your life that you're probably more connected to your values and your own sort of sense of what's right in the world. And I think don't tuck that away. Keep that with you as you go forward, because what ended up happening after that was this. So I quit my job And I was wondering, what the hell am I going to do? But what I really wanted to do was connect to something that I was passionate about. So I happen to be super passionate about sports and healthy living and wellness and so forth. So I looked at a bunch of different companies, either to buy or start something. And the way things work in life is sort of strange. I came up with the idea for Athleta in my sleep, which is so odd. So 3 a.m., I can remember the night. I can remember exactly where I was. And I literally came up with the idea in my sleep. I could see exactly what the brand was. So when I tell you I have no business being in investment banking, I'm a visual guy. I'm a brand guy. I see things visually. So I could see exactly what this thing was. And what I did when I woke up was, I was like, wow, that was a hell of an idea. That was like, there was some imprint that made on me. I started to do research. And I started to look at the market. And we were talking about this today with Tucker, right? Such a cool idea, but it reminded me back to that day when I was analyzing the market. The market at this point, if you can believe it, was completely tilted towards men. So the square footage in retail was predominantly men. The products that came out were basically men's or unisex dyed pink or purple, and kind of shoved in the back of the store. So it's kind of hard to believe that this market now is probably the most competitive market, that sort of the active market, if you will, particularly for women. There are 700 companies in North America who are doing this alone. Right? So somehow we hit the timing right, but I guess the other thing to know here is pay attention to your own instincts and your own intuition around ideas that you have, because they turn into things like this, for God's sake. Then I jumped out of the apparel world for a long time and went to the health and wellness resort called Mirabal in Tucson, which was a great, great experience. Spent a little bit of time in academia and then was asked to come into prAna. And this is prAna. So the thing that attracted me to prAna was the fact that it was a company that stood for more. And I see my role very much as being a catalyst for values and thinking about how business can be a catalyst for good and using the business as a platform for change. So that's the thing, that social mission around prAna is the thing that really got me, plus the fact that it was a very extensible brand. So I knew about prAna early days because when I started Athleta, we actually sold a bunch of prAna. So I knew the style, I knew what they were all about, I knew the people, I knew it was pretty exceptional. And so when I had the opportunity to join prAna, it was just a fantastic opportunity. So the timing was right. It was kind of post. The financial crisis was just, it was in complete implosion. The brand was really struggling. It was sort of stuck at $30 million in sales for like 5 years. It was really struggling in terms of the model, gross margin, and so forth. So we were able to really grow the business, put together a great strategic plan with Michael Crooke, by the way. Sat in a room for 2 weeks and worked on a great strategic plan. And we've been following that plan ever since. So just to give you a rough sense about the basics of it, so the whole idea here is to attract the next generation of prAna. So the brand's been around really since 1992. And moving the company into the next generation, so because it's a strategy class, I give you some pointers on this. So Tim hit on a bunch of these things. But basically, 65% of the business is women's, 35% is men's. One amazing thing that's happening in the consumer market is the men's market is growing like mad. Nobody knows why it is. It's because of the internet, and people are no longer shopping only in retail. But this is the fastest, the men's business is the fastest growing segment of our business, which is pretty amazing. As a California company, people, I think that, lightweight products, spring and summer company. When I first got to the company, I printed out for the design team the average temperatures on a 12-month basis across all regions of the U.S. And I gave it to the design team. And you would have thought I actually gave them the Bible. Because nobody even realized that I actually got cold outside of California. So what we tried to do was actually shift the business model. We were so tilted towards spring and summer that we were unbalanced from a cash flow perspective. So we had to balance the business model out there in a big way. So now it's almost half and half in terms of fall and spring and summer. As Tim said, we're very tilted towards North America. And this is one of the big opportunities that we have going forward is to become a truly global brand. So that's the aspiration of us as a company. In terms of the actual business model, so when I got to the company, it was about 95% wholesale and about 5% direct-to-consumer. Now it's 70% wholesale, 30% direct-to-consumer. The thing that you guys are witnessing right now is a massive change in consumer behavior. So there's a massive change in how people are transacting and therefore how they're interacting with brands. And it used to be that the brands were in the driver's seat. The brands are no longer in the driver's seat. You guys as consumers are in the driver's seat. And how each one of you is interacting with brands, both in terms of the fluidity of how you mix from channel to channel to channel, and the timing around it, is totally different than it was even 10 years ago. So that's changing a lot. And this is one of the shift in the business model is moving much more towards direct consumer. We're putting a lot of effort and attention into this as well. We also have 7 stores at this point, which is part of the direct consumer business. And if you look at the regions where we are, we're going after a very affluent, very educated, very savvy, very progressive customer. And so these are the main regions where we are. We're also looking at Washington, D.C., we're looking at Seattle, and we're looking at Boston. And as Tim mentioned, too, 65% of the business is lifestyle. So people think, are you guys a yoga company? Are you a climbing company? We're neither of those things, right? Or we're both of those things. But we're really supposed to be a brand that actually stands for more. And it's the feeling that you have when you're actually doing those pursuits that gives us the license to be a much bigger brand, right? So what's happening in the apparel world, particularly as it relates to this industry, is style is converging with performance. And our job as a company is to totally blur the lines and break all the rules on that front, because that's the direction of the market. So this is one of the reasons why the lifestyle business is so big for us. And then it's augmented by this piece, which is the active part of the business, and also trying to bend the rules about what active means. So you can see from a growth perspective, it kind of worked out okay. Right? So when we got to the company again, it was around 30 million, and it's grown pretty darn well. So when you think about what the customer looks like and kind of what our whole mission in life is, I mentioned at the beginning about trying to be a brand that stands for more. This is our internal mantra, to be the next great consumer brand in Seoul. So what does Seoul mean? You know, you probably know a handful of companies in the world that actually have soul, that are trying to stand for more and have bigger principles and bigger values. But there's not that many of us, right? So I was invited to this conference a few years ago, and there were 8 companies involved in it. So it was John Mackey from Whole Foods, it was Blake from Tom's, it was Eileen from Eileen Fisher, a few other people. But we looked around the room and we said, God, there's not a whole lot of people that are trying to stand for more and use the business as a platform for change. You guys have a phenomenal opportunity, and the consciousness that you have around the importance of sticking to your values and using the business as a catalyst for growth is really important. So as we grow and we think about the next generation of customers, right, it's a different mindset. So how people relate to activities is really different. So it used to be when the company was founded, people would go climbing alone. Basically, the outdoor industry was founded by white guys going in the back country to get away from everything, right? It's completely changing now. It's much more of a social adventure. And the color is changing around the industry. So this is something, as you guys contemplate, those of you who are interested in getting into the outdoor industry, the tectonic plates are really shifting in the industry pretty profoundly. Also, the customers now don't define one activity as their thing. And this is all based on customer research that we've done over the last year and a half. Right? So people do, they ski and they climb and they do yoga and they run and they do this and they do that. It's always an and. When you ask customers what they do, they have a real hard time pinning down, particularly younger customers, that one thing that they do, which is also a different thing. There's also a hair trigger around the necessary evils of service. So the art of customer service is kind of a lost art. Columbia team and the prAna team, we'd love to take that very seriously because we think it's a big differentiator. But but there seems like there's a lot less patience with companies messing up. So think about it. You spend all this money trying to acquire a customer. It's expensive. Customer acquisition is expensive in all channels, in all industries. If you spend all that money to acquire a customer, you have to make sure it's an amazing experience. And if you blow it, you just have wasted a whole lot of money. So that's why we focus a lot on service. So of the customers that have been with prAna since 1994, 62% of them think our values around sustainability are really important. Of the customers that we've acquired in the last 4 years, 82% think it's important. So the difference is age, which I'll show you in a moment here. And people love this paradox around buying things and consumption, but also trying to be a little bit more measured around their choices, so more conscious consumers. And then healthy living, so trying to use activities to stay fit. So this is the profile. So this is sort of the psychographic profile, if you will, of the customers that we're dealing with. So I'm going to show you guys a video. Hopefully this pops up here. And we have good audio. This is an internal video that we have. So as we think about progressing and moving forward as a company, this is kind of our internal mantra to open up the aperture of the brand, if you will.
Every moment has an opportunity. From our humble beginnings, we've made products that help our customers reach places many can only dream of. And today, prAna is going to help them rewrite the rules, reroute the roadmap, and let all routines be damned. A world for the curious, for the creative, for the spirited, where we play long, travel lightly, and trust our instincts. Cutting the strings that tie us down, we're mindful of the future and humbled by our experiences. We go together when it's better than going alone. We share our stories, toast our friends, and pursue the adventures worth pursuing. We take the time for the things we love, with no compromises and few worries. Free to find our way. Welcome to prAna, design that sets you free. The essence of our style is versatility. We use the best sustainably sourced materials that work wherever you are, from the bonfire to the studio and back to the mountain. We're united by the drive to try new things and lead a meaningful life. We look deep within ourselves and explore the world around us. We give a damn, not just about how our materials are sourced and manufactured, but the opportunities they provide you. It's important to remember, we're not in the business of making clothes. We're in the business of setting the human spirit free. We see design as a way of life, a business philosophy, and a platform for positive change. We imagine the possibilities and bring a unique perspective to every day. We encourage adventure and innovation and welcome everyone to live a creative and unconventional life where anything is possible. We're proud to be different and excited for the surprises each day brings. This character, our character, is how we embody our mission and bring our brand to life in all we do. The moment has come to continue our journey and inspire a new generation to the prAna way of life, where clothing sets you free to create, explore and play, to try new things, stretch and grow. We know we have what it takes. Let's go.
research that we found is unless you're pretty deep in those communities, you do not come across prAna. So you can see here slowly opening up the aperture of the brand, so the association of what the brand stands for and what it represents and bringing new people into the company. You can see it sort of slowly evolving here. So that's been kind of a fun project for us as we go forward. So you want to, should we get in this or should we go to the Q&A? What's the best thing? Okay, so advice, by the way, is about worth 10 cents. And this is not quite the advice section. This is a little bit more like some things that I guess I'd love to share with you that I've learned over time. And most of it is just taking mistakes and bumps and bruises and scar tissue and just sharing it and just kind of giving you a sense for things. So the first thing, and I think if you contemplate kind of the next phase in your life, just six things maybe to consider. The first piece is around making sure that your internal compass and values align with where you're going in terms of companies that you're joining or organizations you're joining. When those two things come together and you mix it with a little bit of passion, it's super profound. And it's really this type of energy that is elusive, and not a lot of people in the world get an opportunity for that. So the notion around alignment and making sure that you ask the right questions on the way in for what a company represents. And by the way, beware of the plaque. Companies put their values on a plaque, but you have to go underneath that and find out what are the behaviors that you see inside the company that actually represent and reinforce those values. So that connection around values is really powerful. The second thing here is, and this is particularly true if you're thinking about starting a company, get super comfortable with this word, because the entire world when you get out of school is around the word no. So I'll give you a few examples. When I came up with the idea for Athleta, we had no capital behind us initially. We had a business plan, which I'll talk about in a moment. But really, we had nothing. We had an idea, right? So we needed space. We needed to raise a whole bunch of money. I needed to talk a whole bunch of people into coming into the company. I got probably 1,000 no's. When I tried to raise money, I went to 1,000 different meetings around just contributing capital into the company. It's a different thing now, because Athleta's been successful, Lulu's been successful, Lucy's been successful, so the investment world has changed around this. But you kind of have to develop a little bit of a thick skin around the notion of no, particularly if you have an idea that you're passionate around. Third thing here is there's stuff that all of you were born with that you're probably really good at. And if you don't know what that is yet, you're going to find out what it is. But the thing that I think I learned early on, instead of trying to do everything, you need to know a lot about a lot of different things. You don't necessarily have to be an expert around it, but play to your strengths. So there's certain things that you're inherently good at. And you'll find if you play to those strengths while also learning new things, you really set yourself up to succeed. So here's an awesome thing to go through, and I'll give this to Michael so you guys all have this, but this is called a sweet spot exercise. So you go circle by circle, right? So the one at the top is you list the things that you love doing, right? This is a really informative thing. You'll be surprised and open down to such a simple exercise. The second thing you do is you look at the things that you do not like doing. So the first thing adds calories, adds energy into you, really builds you up. The second thing takes calories and energy away from you. Third thing is knowing what you're good at, which was the previous slide, right? And then the fourth thing is your connection to your values. What do you think the world needs doing, right? So that's why I call this exercise a sweet spot. So this is an interesting little thing to take with you as you go forward, as you evaluate opportunities. So this is your bed. Be really careful who you climb into bed with. And that has all kinds of implications. But I'll share some real stories with you. So this is particularly true on the investment side of things. You guys are all going to bump into the notion of raising money somehow, or people from the outside who have a specific financial interest having a stake or having something to do with your business. Could be a bank, could be an investment bank, could be an angel investor, whatever it is. Their job is to make money. Their job is to take a pile of money and make a bigger pile of money. That doesn't always sort of align with your own values, your own passion, your own ideas, and so forth. So you have to be careful because the shit's going to hit the fan for sure, whatever you do. It's unquestionable. Like, we deal with this on a day-to-day basis. Something is going to go wrong with the business. In fact, it happens on a day-to-day basis. So it's interesting to see what happens to people when the shit hits the fan, right? You see people's true colors. So you need to be grounded as you deal with these folks in the financial world, because they're only doing what they're supposed to do. And they all look like this at the beginning. You see the shiny? Do you remember Jack at the beginning? It's the scariest goddamn movie ever, right? So do you remember Jack at the beginning of the movie? He was super friendly, innkeeper, a really good guy, right? What happened after that? This guy? This happens in the financial community. Know this going in, because it's just part of the whole deal. Third thing, or last thing here, second to last thing, is this has served me really, really well, and when I haven't done this, it has completely burned me. So I still have the business plan I wrote for Athleta. I still have the business plan I wrote for prAna. I still have the business plan I wrote for Mirabel. We've been really lucky in all those places because we did our research. We knew everything about the customer. We knew everything about the market. And we had a great game plan. It doesn't always happen. In fact, rarely do you hit all your numbers in a business plan. But having a good game plan is totally essential for going forward. Like, absolutely essential. You guys are getting great grounding here about how to do that. And I just want to underscore that. Because when you don't have a plan, you're kind of like a hammer looking for a nail or looking for a business model all over the place. And you got to have a game plan. Last thing here is just sort of this connection back to the first thing I talked about, which is, believe it or not, you're going to change jobs. Maybe once, maybe twice, maybe three times, maybe 10 times, right? So the most important thing at this point is to go and get experience. You will use that experience, I promise you, in some way, shape, or form going forward. Like I told you, I have no business being an investment banker, right? It's not my thing. But I'll tell you, I use it those skills that I learned around analysis, valuation, discounted cash flows, reading a P&L, reading a balance sheet. I use those skills every single day as a CEO. So you might not think that the thing that you jumped into has, you know, 100% relevance in the line of what you're doing, but you're going to use it somehow, in some way, shape, or form. So, thank you.
Thank you.
To do some Q&A?
Yeah. That was good. That was really good.
Let's see. How's our mic, Tyler? We good? Yeah. We're good. Sounds okay. Okay, so we're going to get started with basically, I'll just kind of get things warmed up and really, it'd be great if you asked as many questions as possible. This is next 40 minutes is for you. But I'd like to get us started just on one kind of an overview. First of all, you're both really successful. And one thing we often notice with successful people is there's a lot of humility. I was wondering if you could just talk about that a little bit in terms of I don't hear you taking credit for growing $2.5 billion. I hear you passing it off to a lot of other people. I hear you talking to Scott about team and plan and not saying it was me, and, you know, all in places. Would you mind just talking a little bit about that, building teams and humility? Maybe you could start us off, Tim.
As Scott said,
is your mic on?
I hope so. I made a lot of mistakes, and I made a lot of mistakes here at the University of Oregon. My first F was a good example of that. I learned quickly that I wasn't going to be a brilliant academician, but there were a few things that I was good at, and frankly, having people help me get better at those things was really important, and having people help me with the things that I wasn't very good at was really critical. You know, you guys have all had a lot of professors in your experience here. You've had a lot of teachers, and I've had plenty, but I still remember one of the best things I learned was from Bill Winters, who was an advertising professor in the J School, which was, look, if you have an idea, just make sure you ask people whether or not this is a good idea. And it doesn't have to be a brilliant expert. Just see if you can talk to people about, hey, you know, somebody working on the in the plant, somebody working in the distribution center. Hey, do you understand what I'm talking about? What do you think of this thing? And if you're willing to accept criticism, you can really put your ideas and hone them to a much better place.
Well said. Yeah, I mean, I think that I'll tell you what. When I hire leaders, it's the singular thing that I really hone in on from an interviewing standpoint, is because it shows a certain level of self-awareness. I mean, like, we're all completely imperfect as humans, and somehow, either cultural pressure or whatever it is, we're supposed to be perfect. That is not what it means to be human, and we're supposed to connect to each other in some sort of way without, you know, having a whole lot of ego around it. And so the idea of humility is critical. And there's nothing like getting your ass kicked a few times, right, to put you into that space, because when you go through difficult times, it softens you and it connects you, and you realize that you're not as bombproof as you thought. So, I mean, I've got tons of examples of that. So we'd be here all night talking about examples around that. But
that's a nice way to start. Well, we're business students and we're business school here. One of the things that we teach is that in order to scale a business, you really need balanced scorecard. You need the finance, the great product or service, the people and systems. And if you're out of whack with any of those quadrants, you can't scale. So I was wondering, maybe Tim, you could start by, you know, so it sounds like in the beginning, did you have any of those maybe? But you're obviously have scaled the company and you have figured that out. But can you tell us when you were at some point when you realized one part of the quadrant wasn't working, and what did you do about it?
Sure. Well, early on, I mean, I had taken two classes in the business school at U of O. One was accounting, which I'm sure I got a D in. The other was was entrepreneurship, and if I got more than a C, I'd be shocked. But, you know, when I went home to help run the business, I had no idea what I was doing. I worked there in the summertime and holidays and stuff when I was growing up, but running the business, nothing. So if somebody who worked at the company thought I had a bad idea, well, we just fired them. It was pretty simple. It must have been a problem. So that didn't take long till we were pretty much out of people. And then the business was so horrible that we had to get help. And we had a number of people helping us. And frankly, learning, again, what you're not very good at. What I was not very good at was the details of the business. I could be, on a high level, I could understand what I was supposed to be doing. But when it got to the details, and the details in this business are really what separate you from a profitability standpoint from the rest. Getting that help was really critical. Mm.
I mean, I think the notion of scale has a bunch of different ingredients to it. The one that I think people forget is expertise. So as you grow and scale, your business will increase in complexity, and it requires different skill sets along the way as you grow. So expertise is really critical. And then I think what Tim said at the beginning around a balance sheet is phenomenal advice. And that's where we actually got into trouble at Athleta, is we grew so fast that we chewed up cash like you can't imagine. And I got us into a situation where we had not enough capital, and it put us in a real bind. So you're always on this sort of razor's edge of trying to make these bets around growth, but trying to be smart with your resources. I had this great experience. I remember When we rented the first space for Athleta, somehow my family came up to Northern California, and I was super proud, and I remember showing my dad the warehouse, and he's like, holy shit, this place is gigantic, right? I mean, he couldn't believe it. He's like, kind of, what have you done? And within 6 months, we were completely out of the warehouse because we had grown so much, right? But you have these moments where he's half right in that situation, and I'm kind of half right, and you make these bets around trying to scale, but for sure it's around capital and expertise and then systems. I mean, you can't operate a company without systems at scale. I mean, Columbia's just gone through this pretty significant expansion of systems in order to scale for future growth. And none of that is easy, but it's kind of what you have to manage as a leader, is this sort of whole notion around balancing resources.
Before I ask my next question, would you mind moving your chair? Because I just noticed these people can't see you over there because of the screen.
Yeah.
Move up a bit.
Yeah.
So would you guys mind telling us about some of the, maybe some of the real chaos moments where things were just going really bad and what you did to right the ship? Sorry, I didn't prepare you for that.
Earlier today? No, I mean, probably the worst time was when our bank called the note, and I think that we probably owed the bank $1 million or something like that. And we had a negative net worth of $300,000-$400,000 and no prospect of really getting any better. And those were tough times. And so at the end of the day, what we did, we talked earlier today about differentiation and focus. And when my dad died, we had this little tiny group of products that we manufactured, which were a little unique, and we had this huge selection of products that we bought from others and resold. So we had a 56-page catalog with probably 12 items per page, and so we had this enormous collection of stuff, and we just said, we have to really talk about what it is that makes us different. So we shrunk the catalog down to 12 pages and it probably had maybe 15 items in it, and then we said, okay, these are the items we stand for, and we're going to expand our geographic distribution of these products because they're quite unique. And so that's what I did for the first, 10 years, I guess, was travel around the United States and sell this stuff. And we had a little factory that we realized quite quickly we were not only bad at some other things, we were really bad at running a factory. So, we lost money there. So it was really about focusing on having somebody else make the stuff for you and focus on who knew what they were doing, and then we would design it, market it, sell it. And
how did you get, when they called your note, how did you get the funds to keep the company going to make those decisions?
Well, we basically had a bunch of inventory, and so as we sold the inventory, we created a receivable. The bank was loaning us money on the inventory. I'd call it 20% of value, and they would, if it was a receivable, it would be 80% of value. So the faster you convert that stuff into a receivable, the better off you were. And then when we were introduced by Ron Nelson into this Nike relationship with Nisho Iwai, they were providing what they'd call sourcing financing. So we would go to Asia, order some products from a factory. Nisho would open the letter of credit. In those days, people used letters of credit. They don't exist today anymore, but Nisho would issue the letter of credit to the factory, and for a fee, they would manage that production facility and ship us the merchandise and give us credit. So if we made the right stuff, we could quickly turn that receivable, that inventory into a receivable and pay Nisho and start the wheel running again. So that's really how we were able to grow quite fast early on.
Sort of like a Ponzi scheme.
Very similar.
Yeah. Scott?
Well, I think there's probably nothing like the stress of not being able to pay payroll. So if you think about it, you've got a lot of people who are dependent on you, families, their extended families. I mean, it's sort of the domino effect. And so once you've had a couple of those,
It doesn't make you totally paranoid, but it actually, let's just say, it makes you introspective about the business. And I, one of the benefits for me of having gone through a couple of those is the ethic in the companies that I'm involved in now, we always ask the question on a very regular basis, what is working and what is not working, and what are the course corrections necessary to address the things not working? So I don't know. I think it's those experiences where things get pretty rough like that, those are pretty indelible. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they shape you.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Well, why don't we open it up to questions to the audience? Sure. Go ahead, Terry.
I'm going to direct this one to Tim. When you are expanding a business, you're out looking at companies, and there has to be a culture mix. There has to be a value mix. How do you evaluate that mixture and whether it's going to be successful or you're going to end up with a dysfunctional family that you're going to have to break down?
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's, you know, we've never told our investors that we're going to grow the business by acquiring other businesses, but we've been fortunate enough to have a balance sheet where it allows us to do that. But we have to be very careful when we're acquiring a company because we don't have a deep bench, so we can't, if Mountain Hardware goes bad, we don't have a bunch of people we have to send down there and say, okay, you know, put out a fire. Scott was nice enough to, he raised his hand to help us out when things got bad. But so we really have to make sure that we have a team of people that that running the business that we're acquiring, that know what they're doing, have a high degree of understanding, and have high ethical standards. And we can say, okay, as I told Scott's team when we first acquired the business, I said, we don't need another Columbia. What we need is something completely different, and we're not going to be here managing the business. We'll help you with capital. We'll help you with our sourcing base. We'll help you expand internationally. But yeah, but beyond that, we really can't help. And it's really up to his team and Scott to make it work.
Bag a lot. So let's see. So I had a little bit of savings from my days in management consulting. So I sold pretty much everything I had, and then I borrowed some money from some friends and family to be able to do it. So it's sort of that typical friends and family round at the beginning. And but it's, you know, it's tough. I mean, we were talking today about your project. I mean, believe it or not, the gene pool, if you will, of investors who would have appetite for what you're doing is actually bigger than you think. Back in the early days of Athleta, it was almost entirely tech-focused. There was very few consumer-oriented venture people and private equity people. It's totally changed now for whatever reason. You would think that people sort of wised up to the fact that consumers are 2/3 of the GDP, right? But I think that you've got a solid idea, and I think you might have not an easy time, an easier time than you think in that.
So. So I know we talked a little bit earlier today, and you know I'm an entrepreneur starting a company, and so I appreciate your comment just now about the challenges of, you know, when it comes down to things like payroll, and you know, those are things, of course, that I'm starting to think about. Looking ahead at, you know, all of those challenges that I'm going to be facing, and I'm wondering, during those really hard, even dark times, how do you personally move forward as a leader and continue to lead effectively without, even when you're in a somewhat compromised emotional state and very stressed, where do you find that strength? And, is it just fear that it keeps you
Well, I think, the thing that I learned early on is that as a leader, people cue off of you. You're sort of this, you know, people look at you to see how you're reacting to a situation. So I think the thing I learned early on is, hey, be careful of your energy and how you carry yourself and kind of how you model this behavior. Because again, for better or for worse, people look to you to be able to cue what's going to happen in the future. So I think, you know, this is a little bit why I made a big deal around values and so forth and your own principles, is because, you know, you're going to go through these gnarly times, really, really tough times. And so you being grounded as an individual, that's really where it starts, is your own awareness, self-awareness, and being grounded is really critical. So get it wherever you can. Get it exercising, meditation, being outdoors, whatever it is. But you need something to be an antidote, because the stress will get to you at a point where it seems like, holy cow, I can't even deal with this. It's so hectic. So I think you guys will all have a different source around that, whether it's your own spirituality, whatever it is. You have to draw on something, nature, again, exercise. I think I found from my perspective that exercise really, really helped me. Like, I got to get out and move my body and move some of that energy around. And I think the meditation thing for me personally has been super powerful. But I didn't always, like, hold it together. You know, you're going to lose your shit sometimes.
Tim, you want to take that?
Well, there's nothing like ignorance, right? What do you got to lose? I mean, what are you, 25 years old or something? I mean, what the hell? But as long as you know you don't know everything and ask for help, that's really key.
Yeah, that's right. That's great.
Love it. Sally?
Spending time outdoors and socializing themselves to outdoors and outdoor learning. So I'm just wondering, in France, how do you reconcile to this trend of your emerging consumer and where they're spending their time and where their preferences are? How do you meet them?
Well, it's sort of self-selecting. I mean, we don't have much to sell to people that are playing video games, so sort of we have to deal with people that are, who are interested in being outdoors and staying active and skiing or hunting or whatever they're going to be doing. So it's sort of it's a narrower, smaller component. But even that component is highly connected digitally. So it's actually changed the way we talk to consumers and attract consumers to the brand, because we know that they're going to be spending, everybody spends a certain amount of time on their device. And so, you know, it's helped, but it's sort of self-selecting.
I'm dealing with this right now as an 8-year-old, and it's actually shocking. I think that from a cultural perspective, we are, I don't know what the longer-term ramifications of this are going to be, but I think they're profound. So one thing that Tim said is really important, where I think he was going, is you have to be super savvy on the digital front to be able to appeal to certain customers. So you have to inspire, and you have to really transport people. So sitting next to you is an amazing photographer named Boone Speed. Wait, put your hand up, Boone.
Yeah.
So some of the most iconic climbing images that you could have seen from around the world were shot by Boone. And so the reason why someone like Boone is so important is because his talent captures what it's like in those moments, and so we have to be inspirational from that perspective, because it's pretty damn difficult to pry people away from their devices, and I'm seriously worried about the future generation about that, and the only way that I can think about coping with it is to make sure that the experience that they have when they're interacting with the brand is entertaining and inspirational and transcends whatever the medium, whether it's brick and mortar or whether it's digital. It has to transport them somewhere. So, but boy, that is the question for the looming question for the next generation. That's for sure.
We have one in the back. The woman in the back. Yes.
My name's Hannah. I run a bicycle manufacturing company, and I really enjoy the way that you verbalize business as a catalyst for change. Platform for change, and I'm really curious how you would verbalize the change that you are attempting to catalyze with your brands.
You
want to
go first?
No, you go first.
environmental perspective, there are finite resources, right? I mean, that is not negotiable. That is an absolute fact. And so trying to be conscious of how we use those resources and how to be the least harmful we can possibly be matters a lot. So this is a dirty industry. The supply chain is dirty. And so it's incumbent upon us, because of the downstream effect of that, to be smarter to mitigate some of that damage, whether it's water, whether it's energy, you know, whatever it is, pesticides and so forth. So I guess the thing that the pillar for us as a company is making sure that we're super sharp about the materials that we're choosing to go into our products. So, you know, you probably know the statistics around organic cotton versus conventional cotton in terms of soil depletion and water usage and pesticides and so forth. But our denim is now 100% organic cotton. We've eliminated rayon, which has some pretty difficult impacts from an environmental standpoint. So there's one big piece around sustainability. Another big piece is making sure that the conditions that people who are working on our products in are fair, are equitable, they're not put in harm's way. You know, the Columbia team has actually helped us out a lot. And, you know, Columbia doesn't really publicize this, but they're way ahead on a lot of these things. And it's probably because of Tim's humility that this is not doesn't get a lot of airtime. But Columbia's standard for factory conditions is really, really quite high. So we're drafting off of them in this particular domain. And then I guess the last piece of it is around, we have a word internally we call SEVA, which basically means service without expectation of anything in return. And that means going into our local communities and the communities that we're in and trying to help out. So I guess it's just trying to use the business to be positive as opposed to just taking, to figure out how can we give back, how can we be a platform for change without being preachy about it. So, how about that?
Yeah, and it's interesting in our business. Scott's team is really focused on these core principles, which is one of the things that attracted our company to his company. As it relates to the Columbia brand, we talked about ways to differentiate your company. So in this environment, we compete with people that's their sole point of differentiation, and that's so we have to be different. So we don't talk much about what we do from a sustainability standpoint, but it's enormously impactful. As an example, we saved a lot of money, but more importantly, saved a lot of fuel oil and bunker fuel, and we initiated a process to stuff the containers of the merchandise we bring from Asia much more completely. So those kinds of initiatives to try and do right and do well for our investors and for the company are how we really focus our time and effort. We're launching a product for spring 17. It's a rainwear product, so it might work here in Eugene. But it's completely devoid of any dye stuffs. It's made of 100% recycled products. It's an enormously impactful product on the environment. And we're sort of struggling with how we talk about it because it's not typical for our company to be shouting about our greenness. But anyway, it's about what you do, not what you talk about, I guess.
Yeah, and one additional part of that is I think the consumer landscape is changing. I think consumers are wising up and becoming a lot more discerning, whether it's because there's a lot more publicity or a lot more exposure on it. Consumers are getting smarter and are trying to match their dollars or at least their choices with companies that either represent their values or connect with their values, or represent values that they aspire to if they're not quite there yet. And so this is a very, very important thing for prAna. This is, you know, kind of stake in the ground type of thing, and we need to keep moving forward. We have a 20-year sustainability plan. Who has a 20-year sustainability plan, right? So we take this stuff really seriously. But I think this is going to be the new normal. And I think if companies want to be successful in the future, we have to be stewards of the environment and of people.
Right here in front. Yeah.
It's kind of following up also. I was decisions took to get there, and even more so, you talk a lot about kind of learning your lesson. You knew a ton about the customer that you were trying to, and the feeling you were trying to achieve. I'm curious kind of the research that goes into that process.
Well, I guess the first thing is when the company was founded, it was not really founded as a yoga company or a climbing company. And the founders couldn't quite articulate that, but they were after something that was bigger. And so I guess I would sort of put it to you. You guys know when you're out on your bike or you're climbing or you're surfing or you're whatever your thing is that you're doing, you get a real connected sense of joy and a real connected sense of presence. And that's a feeling that actually we're trying to convey as a company. So I guess from my perspective, it's pretty limiting to think of yourselves as a climbing company or a yoga company. We're after something bigger. You know, we're after that feeling and trying to convey that feeling, which is why I talk about Boone and his photographs. But also that second piece of using the company as a platform for change. So in my sense, when I got to the company, and I think Michael would probably echo this, like, this company has the potential to be something bigger, and I think it's kind of reductionist to think of it as a climbing company or yoga company. So I guess that's number one. The second thing around research is, as I mentioned, when we asked our customers how much they knew about prAna, it has a very low brand awareness in general. But the feedback we got, again, is if you're not pretty damn deep in the climbing community or the yoga community, you don't know about prAna. And so if you're after the big idea, per se, which is around this feeling of that joy you get of being in the moment and being present and being a company that stands for more, you got to get out of that world to a certain extent. And that doesn't mean that we abandon it. It's still a critical pillar of kind of our ethos and where we come from. But we just relied on a lot of research to be able to play that back to us. And so how the research works from a methodology standpoint is we talked to three groups. We talked to people who are current customers, customers that abandoned the brand, sort of bought from us once and then went away. And then we took the profile of both of those guys and we matched them up and found future customers who didn't know about the brand. And we asked a ton of questions. And then we also went for 70 of those people, we actually went into their houses. Craziest thing in the world. You're looking through somebody's closet. Like, who allowed you to do that? But somehow, we were able to do that, and you find out a hell of a lot about how people live and what their needs are when you go into their house. So that body of information informed a lot of research, and at the same time, we triangulated that research with where these people live in the country. So that's we've got a lot of information. That's why I said, you know, at the end here, like, do your homework, do your research, because there's no substitute for that. If you can pour a whole lot of money into trying to find customers, and if you're just guessing, you're going to potentially waste a lot of money.
Okay, we've got one question here, and then we'll go this way.
Well, it's, you know, at the end of the day, we're selling apparel, right? So what differentiates prAna from Mountain Hardwear, from Columbia, and frankly, we've got apparel and Sorel, is the personality of those brands. And so it's difficult to describe. It's even more difficult to accomplish. And there are points of friction where, I mean, actually, we sell outerwear in every one of those brands. So it's about the personality and how the points of differentiation, which are defined by the people who are designing and merchandising the product, to each sliver. And Scott's team is way more focused on research than we have been at Columbia. We're probably more on, let's throw a bunch of stuff on the wall and see what sticks. Because the stuff that sticks in Chile and the stuff that sticks in Russia is very different. So we don't use the kind of
science as much as we should, frankly. We can learn a lot from Scott and his team, but it's about how to make it different. As I said earlier, nobody needs another brand of this stuff. There's brands, you know, if you think there's a lot of brands in the U.S., just go to Europe and or China. And it's all about figuring out what your point of differentiation is and then focusing on that and emphasizing it.
So, Natalie, just to add one thing, maybe go down in the weeds on that for one second. I'll give you an example of how I sort of have this idea that I'd love to help drive Columbia faster and we can help, but it's now actually one team working on this. So here's a great example of how I think maybe the gist of your question is, okay, how is that actually impacting how they play out? So we have a code of conduct in terms of what we expect in factories in terms of the environment and how people are treated and how they get paid and when they have breaks and all that. We're pretty serious about it. Columbia has an equally, if not more, serious code of conduct, and we actually put the two together, and one team sat down and looked at those two things, and it turns out the Columbia team liked a whole bunch of stuff that the prAna team was doing, and vice versa. So we now have one code of conduct, which is, I'd like to think, is an elevated code of conduct. And then I think, you know, the Tim's example, this product that's going to come out in spring 17, with recycled product and no dyes, is transformational. Like, the outdoor industry is bad news from an environmental standpoint. This is revolutionary, and it's going to change a lot of people's perspective about what Columbia stands for. And I think it's going to put Columbia in the proper light of things that they've been doing for a while. So, thank you.
Hi, my name is Billy Jay, and I'm trying to build a career that unites financial analysis with sustainability. And today we talked about business as a force for positive change. We've also talked about the financial crisis in 2008. And you're one of many who have heard from who have this constant refrain of investment banking and management consulting to find great value in their experience, but eventually came away with a cultural mismatch. I wonder if you could speak to us a little bit about the culture of productivity and analysis that you left and the culture you're trying to build at prAna.
Well, I mean, Tim makes this point. I mean, I've learned a lot from Tim as it relates to asking the hard questions about the business. And you can't have sustainability and you can't have all those great values unless the company's doing well. Right? The company has to be profitable. And otherwise, guess what? You're a what? Nonprofit. Right? You cannot do that. You can have the greatest values in the world, but if you don't have your act together in terms of the basics of the nuts and bolts of productivity, it just doesn't work. So, first of all, you got to get the basics down on that front. And it's kind of, the answer to that is not an or, not one or the other. It has to be an and. So, I'll give you a nuts and bolts example. So, 5 years ago, our gross margin as a company was 44%. Now it's 49.2%, right? So we've made pretty substantial progress as a company. We've quadrupled the number of sustainable styles we have in our line during that process. So we've been able to increase gross margin, which is the single biggest cost that you have as an entity. But we've been able to do it without sacrificing our principles. So I think it's, you have to have this balance in doing that, and it has to be an and. Eileen Fisher is a great company. You guys are not the target market for Eileen Fisher, but they're a very values-based, very principled-based company. And Eileen talks about the world in very much the same way. You've got to be profitable, and you've got to throw cash off to be able to invest back into the company. And they have their logo for their sustainability effort is an ampersand and. Because they want the world thinking about not this or that, but and. So that's always my answer on this front, is there's going to be compromises. And you have to make some choices for the health of the business sometimes that are not going to kill you on the margin front. But I just think it's critical to not think of not bifurcate the world like that in terms of.
Yes. I'm just wondering if you could talk about, as a leader, like a specific moment where you just made a really bad decision, or if you can think of maybe it was an okay decision didn't turn out too well, and how you kind of dealt with that specific like issue. I mean, you can go a little bit general, but I just want to know what that's like. Either.
I think we should collectively teach the whole class. So, you want to start, Tim?
Yeah, I listened. I'm trying to think of the worst one because there's so many. You know, it's probably, frankly, product decision or people decision, hiring somebody that was you thought was going to be very effective and wasn't, and frankly, took forever to make the decision to you know make a change, and those are the mistakes that have been very costly for our company. And I can point to myself as being the culprit. But, you know, it's tough when you grow up with somebody and you put a team together and everybody's working really hard and you have somebody that just doesn't, for whatever reason, it doesn't work. And then that's a problem. But we've made plenty of product decisions that were, you know, wrong. When we first got in the footwear business, we didn't really know what being the footwear business was. So our salespeople that were traveling around the United States were being followed by the Sorel salespeople. This was before we bought the company. And they were selling boots to match our jackets. So, God, this is good. We've been the footwear. So we actually went and talked to Rob Strasser. I don't know if you've read the Knight book, you know about Rob Strasser. He's a very famous guy in the Nike lore who ultimately had a big blow up with Mr. Knight and left the company. And things were ugly anyway. We went to Rob and said, hey, what should we do? You know, should we be in the footwear business? And he said, thought about it. So I'll call you. So he called back and said, well, yeah, you probably should be in the business, but we have this license, contract with Adidas, and, you know, precludes us from doing any of this kind of stuff with any other company, but screw it. You guys are Portland guys. We'll help you. So they came up with this cross between a Sorel boot and an athletic shoe. And it was an enormous success, but we wanted to call it a mother ducker. And fortunately, we didn't. So anyway, that's a mistake that we almost made.
But in other words, encouraging people to risk, but the peril is part of this. And I'm not cool with repeating the mistake, right? So I'm all for making mistakes. I think, like, in the spirit of trying and progression. But repeating mistakes, that's not good, because it's counter to want to being a learning organization where you actually put that learning to work, put those trip ups to work. My biggest one is around capital. You know, I alluded to it before with Athleta. Is we had a situation where the company was on fire. I mean, we were going 250% a year and just chewing up cash because we were trying to get in front of it. And the business model really needed some fixing. And we were raising money, and then the financial crash happened. And one of my investors, right before the crash was about to happen, private equity guy, smart, been around for a long time, Michael Crooke, knew him, unfortunately passed away. He came to me and he said, hey, you know, you need to do another round of money raising, and you know, here are the basic terms that I think you should be thinking about. So basically, he didn't give me a term sheet, if you will. But he stepped up and he said, I'm willing to do it, but the terms are rough. And I was sort of this cocky, young entrepreneur, and I was like, we don't need it, no way, we can work this out. And it completely bit me in the ass. And what I had to do later on, after the financial crash really manifested itself, I had to take money from Jack Nicholson, the shining guy. I had to take money from a group of those guys, and ultimately I lost control of the company. And you know the story. It sold, you know, 6 months later for $250 million, and I walked away with zero. So that's one that you don't really forget about too easily.
That's a good one.
How about the young man in the middle there?
Yes, he is. I have a question for Scott. So, I'm like wondering, so how do you measure a person? Is he or she like a super to start up a business? Okay.
So he's wondering, how do you measure a person if they're a superstar or...
Is that correct? No, it's just like, how do you measure like a person, like your probably your family relatives or like your colleagues? How, like, is this person like suitable to start up a business together?
How do you evaluate somebody who's fit to start a business?
Yeah, together, I mean.
Or pick a partner.
They have to be totally insane. I think, you know, a couple things about that. One is your risk profile in starting a business is different than the rest of the population. You just have to square up to that fact. Some people are really okay with risk and trying new things, and some people are really not okay with it. So it's kind of how we're all wired. So it's like Tim used a really interesting term. It's sort of self-selecting, right? Only a certain part of the population is actually nuts enough to start a business, right? Or think that they've got the edge enough to be able to do something that either nobody's done before or do something better. So that's number one. Number two, in terms of picking a partner, if you will, I would say play to your strengths. So hire the thing, do the opposite of play to your strengths. So hire where you are weak and really go after the skills that you covet or you think are really critical for the business. So when I started Athleta, there's a whole bunch of stuff I knew nothing about. It was a direct marketing company. I knew nothing about that. It was an apparel company. I knew nothing about that. So I needed to get people on the team who were awesome at those things right from the get-go. And because those are critical success factors in terms of making the company fly in the future. So, does that help?
Yeah.
That's me. Yes, Tim, you know, it sounds like the first couple years when you took over the company were pretty demoralizing, especially with the family connection to the business. I was just curious, is there an event that you can look back to where you really kind of thought that you might actually pull this thing off?
Yeah, and not a particular event, because, you know, part of being successful, I guess, is not ever sort of losing that, man, we could go broke here kind of feeling, at least for me. Others may be driven by something else, but, I mean, there was a time when I said, hey, you know, I guess I can take more than, like, $400 a month in salary. There was that, you know, I might have gone to $500, but, it was mostly about fear of failure, frankly, and frankly, it still happens today. You know, we're publicly held and we have a huge balance sheet, but frankly, we're competing for capital with companies that are much larger than us and frankly, even more financially successful than we are. And that's a huge motivator to make sure, hey, who wants to be average? You gotta be better than average.
Eddie?
Yes, my question is about core products and brand identity. And I think about Columbia as an Oregon. You know, the PFG line is huge and iconic. And coming from a Northwest brand when you launched it, how do you continue to, you know, basically reach into these new markets, particularly from an internal perspective, and keep your team aligned and have that core that brings you to
the team? Well, the iconic product in our company that really launched our business was a fishing vest, which my mother designed with my dad and a few of his buddies having some beers and talking about, hey, put a pocket here, put a pocket there. So we knew we had something there, and that actually, we built a business on the back of that. So when we said, okay, we're going to have to increase our geographic distribution and our seasonal distribution, okay, so That's sportswear. So why would anybody buy sportswear from a company that makes fishing vests or ski jackets? I mean, it doesn't make any sense. So, okay, well, fishing is close to, you know, the fishing in Florida is similar and it's sunny all the time. And so let's launch this kind of sun protective product in Florida that would be, you know, performance apparel
for guys that fish out in the Gulf and do all the stuff that you know about. And it just was serendipitous that it became so popular. Now, how do we hang on to that? Because there are lots of companies in Florida that are following our lead. And so today we had, was today Monday? Whatever. Yesterday, we had a team of guys go to the Keys, and these are all product people. You got to know what's going on there. You got to, what's the next deal for PFG? What's the next approach for our products there? And how do we make sure that we're relevant? And go talk to some of those guys at Auburn or Alabama and find out why they like this stuff so much, and let's make sure that we make it right.
We have time for one more question. Yeah, go ahead, Brian.
So my question is more geared to Scott, and with so much success from prAna, and more social, holistic companies, you know, as a lot of newer companies that claim to be sustainable, socially responsible. And so my question is, so many entrepreneurs, how do you differentiate between an authentic social entrepreneurial company and a not-so-authentic one?
Wow. Well, I think it's proof, right? So one thing that is interesting about some of the consumer research that we have done is consumers need some sort of signal around proof. And there's two or three different types of consumers, but basically not that many of them go three layers deep to sort of figure out, okay, what materials you're using, what's the traceability policy, what factories are you using, all that stuff. So it's kind of easy, you've heard this term greenwashing, right? And you guys in the sustainability program probably hear a lot about this. It's pretty easy to pull the wool over the consumer's eyes, and a lot of companies do it. And so I guess the only way that we think about that is, A, we've got to keep running ahead and making sure that we're ahead of the market. We got to tell the story a little bit, and we're not as humble as Tim, but I think in the scheme of things, prAna's been a pretty humble brand, and we're kind of like whispering for many years. We've got to turn up the decibel level a little bit without shouting. But I think we have to be very, very credible in the areas that we're in. And whether it's materials that we use for the products, or the gear we use for the business, or the working conditions piece, those are kind of the three big pillars for us. And I don't know, I think part of it is our own internal compass too, and wanting to always be right and wanting to be better. But I think it's a really good question. I'm not sure there's any sort of way to protect against it. And I think Tim would probably say this too. There's probably outerwear companies or even fishing companies that are trying to outflank us in one way or another. And that's why you just have to keep innovating and keep progressing moving forward.
Yeah, I mean, they say in Texas, if you can do it, it ain't bragging. So.
The gentleman in front, I'm sorry, I wasn't able to take your question earlier. Can you ask the final question?
Yeah, if I can remember. If I remember right, you're targeting direct marketing, that's expanding, and you're also targeting educated communities through your direct marketing. Are you doing any kind of, you're embedded in an academic venue here, but are you looking for telling your story to younger children through the story of global warming, things like that?
prAna is not doing that, and I think there's a couple of different reasons. One is that his business per se is perilous, and Jim can talk a little bit more about that. I think it's important for us as a company to focus on kind of influencing the people who are a natural fit for us and rely on them to sort of pass the word on that. But yeah, we're not really focusing on kids at this point. It's not to preclude the possibility of doing it in the future. And I guess the other way that we get out and, you know, try and spread the gospel, if you will, is just sort of telling stories on whatever platform, social media, within stores, digitally somehow, on what we're doing and trying to sort of create a little bit more focus on some of those causes.
Yeah, I mean, we have a a nice kids business in certain categories, but it's fraught with problems from the manufacturing side. In other words, parents want to buy stuff for their children, which is relatively inexpensive, and that means it drives you to places you don't want to be. And so we, with a few areas where we can be successful, but not a ton.
I meant more from an education.
We're going to go for brainwashing, I think. No, I think, you know, to answer your question, I mean, nothing specific around that, but just relying on, if you will, their parents, the people who are in their sphere, to try and actually connect with their own values or instincts from them to be able to follow them.
So I'd like to thank you all for coming. Really appreciate it. I think we have the Net Impact Club here today. Is that right? Net Impact. We have both strategy sessions. People from the community, thank you very much. And for Tim and Scott, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Our new venture championship.